the structures of care, and study of the structures of care is a study of society. And I made two points last time. One was very abstract and tough one, which I'm going to handle today again. And that particular point was regarding causal closure of human action. This is formulated very abstractly, and I had said that it's formally closed. The human activity is formally closed in terms of formal principles. And because of this formal closure, the back pressure of the formal closure leads to formation of social entities. Social entities are like relations, are like persons, are like institutions, are like roles, including manners and etc., which I didn't cover last time, couldn't cover. Rituals. These are some of the entities and episodes which are constructed in our mind, and they are all constructed only in our mind. I mean, social entities, society does not dwell anywhere apart from our minds, and in our minds, in our memory. There is no place for society to dwell or exist or sort of endure itself except in the memories we have. So in the case of dementia or loss of memory situations, society disappears. Society actually disappears. And these social objects are constructed, though I'm calling it memory now, but in last lecture I called it a bubble. It's a bubble of the consequences of human action. Whatever actions, all of us do actions all the time, we do deeds, some ethereal, mysterious kind of consequence of our actions, they dwell in this bubble. It's a fantastic bubble which is in our head. It's akin to memory because the bubble sort of time doesn't pass in that bubble. There is no time passing in that bubble, and something enters into that bubble and something exits. The consequence of human actions enter into that bubble, and what exits is occurrence of social objects in our cognition. When we think about social objects, they exit from the bubble. In between, on recollection, all social objects are recollected from this bubble. But inside the bubble, there are certain procedures which happen, and these procedures are tied to clustering of this object. For example, whatever that person sort of is all about, whatever actions that person is doing or has done all life, if we collect them together, the consequence of those actions, that will form persona of that person. That will be a persona of this person, and this persona exists differentially in all of us. Whatever we know about the person, etc., accordingly the persona exists in us, in the bubble. And this gets recalled in our cognition as that particular person. That person is entirely different from the individual who is breathing, etc. Because the individual dies, the person never dies. The person can, it's like stars it can show up, it may disappear, it may not show up, but there is no law for person to die. The persons can be the personas of people. There have been billions of people in the past. Imagine persona of everybody is existing. Okay, three of you should talk. That's three, these front people. Three of you should go out and talk. Leave. The three of you should leave. Show me and sort of meet me after the class sometime. Have nice time. So, the billions of individuals who have died have all left their persona. And what is this persona? Persona is a cluster of the consequences of their deeds. The consequences are difficult to imagine, but let's abstractly think that there are consequences, discrete consequences of whatever you do, and which dwell in the heads of others, or phantasmic bubbles in the heads of others. Billions of people have died like that. That is, individuals have died with motor organs, and personas have no motor organs, because even after the person is, individual is dead, the personas live. We can commemorate a person, we can recall that person. When we die, we leave the story behind. We leave our stories behind, and these stories are of that person who has died. There are certain procedures in that persons which create objects, like relation between people are constructed out of a very specific kind of consequences of actions. These consequences can be called as which induce debt, a sense of debt in us. If somebody smiles, it creates a sense of debt in us. We smile back, maybe not then, or sometime later when you meet the person, because that debt is created. Transactions of individual actions, including children to infant to old people, whatever actions they do, they create indebtment structures, indebtment traces. And these indebtment traces cluster into human relation. And what we do for others, others do for us. Not that we do only for others, we do for the world. But in between we find people who pick up indebtment sort of traces. And that constitutes relation. There are a variety of human relations in society. So these relations are, persons are constructed in the bubble. Relations are constructed in a bubble. So relations are the kinship structures. Kinship structures are the structures of care. That three of you also please go out. The next row, three of you also can go out. No point coming to class. You can request me for attendance, actually, without attending a class. Maybe I may give you. You have to leave. But you have to give some reason for it. I mean, requesting for attendance. These kinship structures are something which you can find on your mobile phone, as I said last time, in your directories. You can find your kinship structures, thick ones, right there. There are many other people who are not there. They are also kinship thing, but some live ones you can find in your directory. And all of these kinship structures are actual relations which we have. We also have relations with strangers, and but they are very, one has to attend to them because they are social relations. Each of them And other statement I made was, when you talk to your kin, kin could be a friend, kin could be somebody who you trust for delivery of some goods. A kin could be anybody who you can trust and bank on and from whom you get care. And in different situations of life, you find that. But when you talk to somebody on cell phone, you only talk, you never talk to an individual. In a secondary way, you talk to an individual, you always talk to that person. Person who never dies. An individual always is modifying a person, modifying one's persona. We are all through our deeds modifying our persona to make our career in that bubble. We may, if we really want career, the only career is for all of us, all human beings, is in that bubble. It's not in, I mean, there are other things like jobs, etc., which is fine. We look at that structure also. What really is a job? Out of these relations, there are billions of relations in the past. These billions of relations, the personas can be always divided, cut into portions. Like we can understand traits in person. Traits are section of that persona. We can cluster all the traits from billions of persons, and this clustering of trait is what is called social role. All of us play lots of roles, and sort of all the roles which we play, they are clusters of that. You cut paste from the universe of personas. And this happens very silently, and they are precipitates, or they are like sedimentation from the clouds of consequences of deeds. And roles are made, and out of these roles are constructed institutions. Institutions are designer-made structures around roles. Like IIIT is an institution, is a designer institution which is entirely around roles. And a job is basically that you agree to discharge a role. A well-defined role is what is called a job. And you may end up creating lots of jobs because you may end up constructing institutions. If you construct institution, people will populate it, those roles that you have. When you construct institutions, people believe that, you know, startups are like, at least in IIIT institutions, are constructing institutions. You can construct societies, you can construct trust, you can construct family, you can construct many institutions are there, which some of you will construct. In fact, you would have a role that someday you would be head of an institution. It could be your family, which could be maybe just before you die, you are head of that family or whatever. That you will play lots of roles, institutional roles, all life. And some of you maybe in young age are able to construct institutions. Now, if you look at these structures of roles, we get two kind of institutional structures. One kind of institutional structures, I'm summarizing last time, so that I say something which I didn't say last time, to come to today's lecture. That we there are some institutions which create atmosphere or environment in which disputes are articulated. It's serious what I'm going to say, that there are some institutions you'll find it in your life where disputes are articulated. Whatever discords, disharmony one senses psychologically, one senses, that is articulated. These are very positive institutions because they continuously put burden of resolution of disputes. These institutions continuously put burden of resolving the disputes. There are some other institutions in which don't encourage formation of dispute. There are certain norms by which you have to live in those institutions so that disputes don't come up. Nonetheless, human deeds conflict and disputes do come up everywhere. But then, like IIIT is an institution which expects no dispute among people here. It doesn't happen because disputes do come up. But tendency is to keep them away, keep them, put a carpet on them. That is a tendency. Whereas family and even a relationship between even two people, lots of disputes may come up. These disputes don't threaten family, they don't threaten relationship. But these disputes have to be addressed. Like in a even atomic relation between two people, with time disputes come up and they have to be resolved. In a family, disputes keep coming up and they have to be resolved. In society, disputes coming up, they have to be resolved. There is some institutions which can absorb certain culture in those institutions, like a family culture or kinship cultures which you have. They are able to handle disputes. If disputes are not handled, it becomes very cold and the institutions break. Institutions break. Institutions also break for some other purposes, like, you know, for a positive reason. They don't break, they get separated and reformed again, recouped again, but families may break. This happens often because certain kinship structures which have disputes which are not getting resolved. But there is one more subtle thing which I wanted to say last time. Something called manners. The manners is the way we act, the way we do something, the way we sit, the way we look at people, you know, the way sort of gestures are done. These are all manners, adab, or these manners is also a social object, like institutions. And manners are the clustering of those deeds or actions of each of us which are repetitive. We do repetitive things, like you greet people. You maybe repeat it time and again, greeting people. The way you greet people becomes your manners. So the consequences of repeated actions and often repeated actions, these are called manners. The clustering of these consequences and precipitate into what we call manners. You know, manners are very subtle. Manners are something like the way somebody looks around, or elementary gestures are manners. Very, very atomic elementary gestures can be called manners. The way your hands move, the way you carry your body, the way you style your hair, and these are manners. And these manners are also constructed out of this bubble. Out of these manners, there have been billions of people who have had lots of manners, great variety of manners, because you will see that each of you or each of us differs very fundamentally in terms of manners. I mean, if at all there is a difference among people, there are no two people who have same manners. Our individuality, our sort of difference from others, is that we have differently mannered. The manners are cultural also. They are family, they are school, there are all kind of things, because repeated actions we do all the time. Everywhere in the globe, people do that, repeated actions, and they construct manners. These manners constitute cultures. One of the vital elements of culture, these manners constitute. So a way, say, a person from, hopefully, I mean, some people are saying this, that a person from Telangana has a different manners than person from Simandra. It's worth looking at, but some people are claiming like that. The manners are different, and the way they handle each other is different. The smiles are different, and the gestures are different. All the cultures you will see when you go around the globe, meet a lot of people, within India, lots of cultures, you will see the manners differ of people. And it is a fairly sort of, some people take it as a lifelong sort of venture to look into manners. And some of you will actually end up at the end of your life to have looked into manners of different people in much more subtle way, and noticing the manners of people, and sort of concluding and deducing things. For example, only yesterday, there was a person in, I forget his name, in Hyderabad, who made a very interesting statement on manners. I think his name is Ram Teja or somebody. He's like a consultant for cultural conflict. He has a consultancy firm which handles cultural conflict among corporate institutions, companies which have multicultural people. And like Microsoft or the companies in Hyderabad. So he has a consultancy for handling cultural conflicts. He advises various companies and sort of gives people who want to invest into India from, say, Poland or Brazil, etc., or anywhere. His firm gives consultancy, in a sense, training of what India is, what kind of people are Indians. So Ram Teja is his name. He is a friend of sort of a man who has launched a political party. I mean, some of these people should be able to tell me. He's younger brother of Chiranjeevi. What's the name of that man? Ram Teja, or what? Kalyan, Pawan Kalyan. He's a friend of Pawan Kalyan. He made an interesting statement that in a multicultural situations, he's an advisor to him and a new party, I mean, it's a very thoughtful party, this Pawan Kalyan's party. And his advisor made a statement that cultures, we are living in a multicultural world. Different kind of cultures exist in everywhere, in every institutions. The more we live multiculturally, the more differences come up among people. Cultural differences come up. The more we know others, acculturate with other culture, the more truer we become to our culture. Something like that. It's a very insightful statement she made, but I'm also saying something like that. The manners are like that. Manners can lead to conflict, can be misunderstood. And but we live by them. All of us are condemned to live by, necessarily live by manners. And to really work out being a well-mannered person is a difficult task. It is something to create your persona. people who are well-mannered are people sort of whose personas have lived longer in past. Ill-mannered people also live in the bubble, but longevity is very little. I mean, they get clustered around one kind of role. Out of manners are constructed something called rituals. Manners, like a child is born, there are certain manner child has, a moment of birth. People recall that, you know, that what did the child do first? How did the child weep? What kind of behavior child has? I mean, infant has, just being born. There are manners of a baby just being born. And people try to look differences, something unique about that child, right there. The face resembles somebody, you know, all kind of things are done. There is an element of manner in the child who is born. And the child, when it grows up, it acquires different kind of manners. You know, when it's playful, it's trying to learn how to catch things, trying to track people with the eyes, calibrating body. The child calibrates one's child's body so that various tasks can be done, learn to walk, etc. Their manners of walk. And something are common among children, something are unique. And people do notice that. I mean, if you people can notice, you are a fine, I mean, sensibilities are cultivated, cultured persons. Do notice these things. And so when a child goes for learning or playing, there are certain different manners. When it goes for learning, there are different manners. When the child sort of grows up, gets a job, manners change. Manners are also different, and when you get married, manners change. Your behavior changes over time. At different stages of life, the behavior keeps changing. The manners change. To mark different stages of life is called ritual. What exactly is a ritual? Traditionally, you say, okay, the first food given to a child has to be done in a great, in a very mannered way. You don't just feed child and sort of mindlessly. The first food which child takes, people have rituals for that. It's something which is celebrated. When person gets married, there is a ritual you have to undergo. The rituals, they are traditions. This is, you can do in courts also, marriage. They, nonetheless, even that is a ritual. And sort of coming to IIIT, you have to pass through rituals. And getting a degree from IIIT is also a ritual. They are all rituals. We do a lot of things which are like institutions are constructed out of roles. Rituals are constructed out of manners. You can get this. Actually, this is what I wanted to say last time to you. So without elaborating much on this, I'm going to move on to more serious stuff. By saying there is a lot of processing occurring in this bubble, which is creating all kind of stuffs. Persons, offices, you know, we occupy offices, rituals, a whole lot of things are constructed. Each of them has a different dilation or time deferment in it. They are, each of them are like assurances over time. A persona or a relation is assurance in time. You can always bank on a relation you trust. It's assurance in time. Because these are happening in a bubble which are timeless. in some sense, locally timeless. Not that entities in that are never born or never die. They are born and die. Not die, at least born and disappear. But they sort of, time doesn't pass there in this bubble. It passes on the edges of the bubble, where a consequence enters and some kind of intention exists from the bubble into our head. There are different kind of time, deferment, dilation, etc., which are involved in constructing of these things, but that is formal structure. What we are going to do is to move on to politics. Political science is called sometimes. From society, we move on to polity. Polity is a grand institutional structure. Like when we looked at constitution has formed a polity. The Constitution of India forms a polity. A law actually makes society. For example, there is a law passed on 27th of, declared on 27th of February. There is a, by the government, Manmohan Singh government, this will come into force yesterday. That is, the law has come into force on 1st of April. It's an amendment to a Companies Act. Companies Act, when you people mature up, actually join companies, you will know all these things. The Companies Act is the way companies should behave. And this is an amendment to the Companies Act. It's called CSR law, Corporate Social Responsibility Law. It's actually coming to declared on 27th of February. It's enforced from yesterday. Because of this law coming, a whole lot of changes are happening in society, will happen in society. It's like politically, society is changing. I'm giving an example here. The law says that every company having a profit of more than 5 crores or a turnover of more than 1,000 crores is liable to, when it makes a balance sheet after, in a year, after a year, when the profit is done, which is taxable, profit of any company is taxable, this profit, on this profit, 2% of that profit should be given immediately after profit is indicated, should be given as spent for corporate social responsibility. What does it mean? And the industry has tried hard last year to lobby that this should be tax-free, but it is not tax-free. It is on the profit. This little bit of details, but to appreciate what really polity does to a society, pay attention to this, because it illustrates what's happening right now. Right now, tens of thousands people are worried about this law, as of now, in India. Not in India, internationally. Lots of people are very worried. Lots of consultancy firms are very worried about it. And they want to jump about into it. And it says that in annual report of the companies who qualify for it, there has to be a CSR policy in every annual report. Annual report is what you write for investors. And but there has to be CSR policy section. And what you did for CSR, that section should also be there. These two sections are compulsory by law to be there in every annual report. If you don't comply, there are penalties. There are penal sort of things about it, including arrest and of people, including more than just a financial penalty. And it declares that every company with 3 members of its board in it should form a committee for CSR. That is, the highest body of the company should be liable for a CSR plan. What is CSR? Corporate social responsibility. This has been a directive since last 10-15 years globally, that companies should have some kind of CSR. This was voluntary, and around 100 odd companies in India already have in place CSR structures. But this applies to every company, which means estimate of international estimates are something like 8,000 companies are immediately affected. They can afford to create bigger structures, and more companies. Their total amount of companies in India are 8 lakhs. Gone, bonky, or surviving, etc., whatever it is, but they are that much. And the intention behind this law is, it's an international intention. I mean, UN and other places, everybody's talking. In fact, EU is going to declare this week a directive for CSR. And Canada is also wanting a law. India is the first country in the world which has got a law on this. It's created a precedence of some kind. The intention behind it is that the business models of handling economy and the world and the technology, innovations, etc., the business models which exist have brought in 3 kinds of aberration in society, 3 kinds of negative consequences. One of them is, I'm putting in my words, but you can read this. Some of you should Google this, interested in economy. I want to talk polity here. But one of them is that the care in society has systematically gone down, and there are people who are committing suicide, there are people who are going hungry, there are people, you know, this has happened. Something very negative has happened, that there is a poverty. And there is unemployment, and there is, you know, such things are happening. The one class of issues are there. Another class of issue is that the self-esteem have also gone down. There is some kind of cultural deprivation which one sees in society, in a polity, and one sees social deprivation in polity. And the third, one sees that environment is buggered up. There is environmental deprivation which has come. For these 3 things, it is thought by the polity that the business models of handling the world must pay for them, must necessarily pay for them, because these are something business model can't take care of. So you must leak 2% of fund, which does, which undoes in some way, patronizes social deprivation, cultural deprivation, and environmental deprivation. One should do that. This would get accepted almost every country, including US. And this has been a sentiment for the last 10, 12 years, but it's come to law in India now. There are 10, the law says there are 10 things you can do in the name of social responsibility. It's like poverty alleviation, it's like education, it's like old age homes, set up something like that. You have to do something which creates social good. You can't do something which creates a business environment. You can't do something which has a, which does, helps your business. This money should not go into that. This money must go into social good, which is selfless, which is not in the interest of a company whose 2% is going in. And this money is not something which is to be collected by the government as a tax and through government schemes discharged, it's very liberal, that every company can directly go to people and do it. State is not going to intervene. It's a very progressive kind of law. And every company must have a policy, what they're doing for social good. And what really is social good? So there are 10 kind of things they have written down in the law, which includes poverty alleviation, education, sanitation, all kind of things. And the ninth clause says that through CSR one can fund incubators in academic institutions recognized by the government of India. This is what the law says, exact sentence. Through this fund, one can support incubators which lead to in academic institutions which are recognized by government of India. One can do that. What does it mean? If any of you had a little idea of what incubator is, incubator is that which should have a business model. You know, break even in 3 years, 7 years, whatever it is. Expansion, scaling up. You must have a business model to incubate. That's the idea. But here's a law which is saying, do not have business model and have incubator. What does it mean? It's a serious issue. What does it mean? Right now, the law has created a segment in the economy which at this moment is the fastest growing segment of Indian economy, because 60,000 crores will leak out as 2% in this year. Nowhere in the world you have such a leakage, and one doesn't know what to do with it. So everybody, all sort of companies, consultancies, even philanthropy consultancies are jumping into it. Whoever jumps into it, whoever makes, for instance, somebody makes a portal that watch on CSR money, transparency of CSR money, would do a great, lots of people trying that, would make a life with wings. I mean, the people who are jumping on it will have wings on their life. And it will change. New institutions come up. Now, idea is, what is a incubator which has, which doesn't have a business model? Law is wanting that. What could that be? An incubator which will create social good. Now, what does it mean to create a social good? I mean, this is something that it sort of binds people who are broken. The social fabric is there in this fantastic bubble which we have. There is social fabric. What does it mean to do a social good? Make two people, say mother and child who have gone away for some reason, make them meet together, collect a, or there is some abandoned woman outside the IIIT gate, do something, get her a shelter. What really social good means? And now there is a feeling, very strong feeling. There was a conference last week in Bangalore, a conference on the economics of happiness. I mean, you can Google this. Very interesting. 1,000 people participated in it. There are a lot of young people who would rather get into a venture which does social good than to get into a venture which does, say, business venture. There's a class of people like that globally, internationally, and more in West than in India. I mean, India means, I mean, you are a very small section of people who are doing technology education, young people. And most of technology education people will look into companies for life, for a fulfilling life, good life, to be part of some company, maybe very big companies, and get good pay package. That's the kind of imagination. But here is a force political force which has come, which is making possible a new class of ventures which do social good. And there's a continuous flow of money every year, 60,000 crores, 70,000 crores. Every year this leakage is there in India, is going to be there in the rest of the world as well. So a whole lot of new ventures are going to come. People who can put in imagination would have wings in their life. People, who don't put in imagination would go and match some already created grooves and live their life happily and watch the world and sort of still be happy by watching the world. So I gave this example because you will notice in next few months whole lot of structures, institutions coming up in society, because this money has to go spend, it's too large a money. It's like if suppose we tax all industry, so entire GDP of industry, if you take 2% out of it, the total, not GDP, the profit in the GDP, that thing 2% is that kind of money. And it's supposed to be a liberal polity, liberal theory of politics. This is one of the finest moves which has come out of liberal theory of politics. Manmohan Singh is one of them, liberal. So, okay, let me get back to this. I gave this as an example that there is some law made, and the law is made by a parliamentary committee which was headed by BJP man who did not get ticket from Bihar, whose son got ticket. Huh? What? Yashwant Sinha. It was headed by Yashwant Sinha. Corporate people gave many representations that. Yashwant Sinha, it was headed, who made this law. Murali Dohra was a minister of company affairs which notified this law. And it's a serious thing which has happened. And people who see how serious it is are the people who will have wings on this segment. There are millions other segments, many other segments of society where one can see where you can get wings. Anyway, here is a list of some people, thinkers large in the West. Indian polity is, though come out of national movement, India became independent. The governance in India owes a lot to these people. This set of people, and they are Renaissance people largely, and later on, there is a person called Hobbes. These are some of 10 odd ideas which are very fundamental in political thought. I'm giving a quick review. Hobbes came up with the idea that there is a social contract among people. Why I don't kill you is because I don't want you to kill me. So we agree not to kill each other. The polity is a structure of social contract. I sort of don't abuse you because I don't want you to abuse me. So we enter into contract, okay, we will not abuse each other. So that social contract is what which creates polity. That was the idea, very powerful idea. It will change a lot of old political structures which existed. And the contract is independent of human desire. We may desire something, we may want to kill somebody, but we don't do it. Because the polity says, don't do it. That's a contract. So it's independent of desire people have, and we live in a polity which is independent of desires. That was the idea. Obviously it had weakness because imagination and desires are synonymous. You can have desires which are very small time, but imagination is a form of desire. It's a build up on desires. You may have very ethereal imaginations, and ethereal desires can be there. So there is something which is amiss in this. Spinoza is another person who came up with the idea that political behavior of people, like election behavior or other behavior, is like a rational egoism. I maximize my interest, totally opposite to Hobbes. I maximize my desires. I want to get my desires implemented. But I reason with it. When I'm reasoning with it, that is a political being. So behind political being is certain kind of egoism which is rational, that I look for my interest and I reason with that interest and thus behave politically. So rational interest of self-alliance with pure reason. That there is a thinking in this that my desires and the reason are compatible. In the end, they are compatible in some way. So you have social, modern times, social choice theory, etc. has come out of this. And 11 Nobel Prizes in economics out of this. Locke came up with another idea. John Locke, he was a friend of Newton, who said secondary primary qualities we covered earlier in the course. John Locke, he also wrote on, he came up with the idea of rights, and the idea that people belong to cities. Who belongs to cities? Citizens are the people who live in cities. India has become a big city today. Nearly 50% of Indian population lives in city, in spite of whatever census operation might say. It's really very large. Krishi Pradhan Desh is off the hook. I mean, it's no longer Indian reality. India has become, only citizens have culture, only citizens have technology, only citizens do knowledge. Rest of the people are not citizens, not belonging to city. The idea of citizen as a political entity. What is a citizen? It's not the human being. It's not a citizen. Citizen is a person who either by birth or by domicile belongs to a polity. You become citizens. If you go, say, some of you would try to become citizens of some other country, you will have to become citizens. Just by being human beings, you are not citizen of any country. You are citizen of a country if you belong to a constitution. A constitution specifies laws. And that is what gives you citizen, and citizens have rights. It's altogether a different discourse from rational egoism and a different discourse for social contract. Montesquieu came up with a proper theory of how Indian polity is born. You can see through this list. What really is the political behavior, etc. He came up with the idea that the state is a power which is sovereign, which is known traditionally. A king is as good as a god, or all-powerful. Sovereignty is that which makes laws, but which is not under any law, which is free. It makes laws by considerations and rationality and empathy, but it is not under law. For example, there exists a citizen in India which is exempt, who is exempt from Indian law in some corners of that citizen, and this citizen is called President of India. By logical, there is a logical structure which says there has to be in a polity, in a constitutional structure, there has to be at least one person or one institution which is beyond law. It's a necessity for a, formal necessity which comes. The sovereignty of state, he came up, should not be absolute. It should be limited. Limited in terms of three wings. It's called division of power between legislative, between judiciary and executive. The parliament, the government and the judiciary. They are, the sovereignty should be divided among them. Nobody should have absolute sovereignty. And the person who has absolute sovereignty should be only symbolic. That is the structure. The President of India is bound by what cabinet says. And though there are certain powers he has, which are not, it's a very interesting thing, the doctrine of limited sovereignty. Sovereignty should be limited and cross-checked. You should have polity where sovereignty is a power, exercise of power is cross-checked. Balance of powers is what is politics. Then Rousseau said that this power is not coming out of history, like power of a kingdom. Or, but the power actually belongs to the people. Only people have power, only individuals have power. And individuals may willfully give this, surrender this power to the state. And through gathering, people have power, and social contract as general will, people have will, like the Hobbes social contract is a will of people. People want not to kill each other. There's a will. There is a, and people are sovereign, people have will. And the idea of democracy, that is the people who can give power or who can withdraw power. USSR crumbled in a day because people just withdrew power. It was a mighty empire, USSR, before you people were born, maybe, I don't know when. So, this entire structure, mighty structure, just crumbled in days because people withdrew power. It's actual phenomena which happens. So, people are powerful. People are sovereign and people's will with what counts. Politics is people's will. So, if there are three or there's a fight going on between Kejriwal, Modi and Sanjay, no, Rahul Gandhi. This fight is about people's will. People are wanting this, people are wanting that, people, this is being checked from people. And you people, if you vote, which you should, are exercising your powers. And even if you don't vote, there has to be intention in not voting. People are asking that there should be one column. I want to vote, but I want to vote nobody. The idea of democracy came up. These are thoughts which are behind thinking about the polity. Then Bentham came up with the idea which is very popular in 20s, liberalism. It constitutes a doctrine, political doctrine called liberalism. Social justice as maximization of aggregated individual benefits. This is social choice theory. It has led to so many Nobel Prizes, including that of Amartya Sen. Amartya Sen also is, he has a book on justice. Some of you should buy it or read it, at least reviews or summaries of it. Social justice as maximization of individual benefit. If I maximize individual's benefit, I can create social justice. Like there's a, if you maximize your benefit, here he's saying that reason will prevail. And the social and rational choice theory or social choice theories in the modern times from 60s onwards, Kenneth Arrow came up with this social choice theory based on these ideas. that if everybody maximizes one sole benefit, then certain amount of social good is created. There's a proof for it. There was once a course we did in IIIT, elective course, in which on social choice theory, and there were 42 people in that, and 28 of them got F, including fourth year people, because it was tried once, it just couldn't be taken by the mindset which you have here. But there exists this theory, which is very popular, and it's there in the sentiments that, okay, I care for myself, and hopefully world will be better. You have contentious theory coming up, Karl Marx, very significant for polity, because it changed the political scenario in the 20th century significantly. Is Marxism came up with that basic structure is that the ideas of people are shared. And this share is of an interest. So there is a class which has interest, not individual. Individuals are just a kind of cog in the wheel. There is a group which has, which is a political agent. And this group, there are always two groups, oppressed and oppressed, oppressors and oppressed. And there is a struggle going on between them. And polity is this struggle. And there's all kind of false consciousness, like the oppressors will teach the oppressed religion, like opium, so that they remain oppressed. Those kind of things he came up with, Marx, political economy, and idea of communism, etc., which is very powerful in the 20th century, because it led to formations of very big structures, like USSR, like China, like Cuba, like many other countries in Latin America, and including Korea, North Korea, etc., including, you know, it has a serious effect in India. There's a Communist Party fighting elections right now, all owing to Marx. Hayek is another guy which became, after Second World War, very popular. And because it just went too well with the flood of market or expansion of market, which happened after Second World War, massive market got formed, which we see today. A free market capitalism and state to maintain rule of law. State job is just to keep law, leave economy to people and to free market. That is the kind of polity which should be there. And Hannah Arendt, I would really love if some of you read her. Hannah Arendt is a Jewish woman who had to sort of run away from before Second World War from Germany because of threat to her life. And she settled in US. Israel caught the Mossad. Mossad is an institution of Israel. It's a secret service of Israel. Like we have IBs, etc., secret service, India, RAW, they had Mossad. They have been hunting since Second World War some of the war criminals. They caught one hiding somewhere in Latin America, Honduras or somewhere. One guy who was the minister of Hitler, responsible for concentration camps. The concentration camps, he was responsible for exterminating lots of people. So he was discovered and was airlifted and brought to Jerusalem and to Tel Aviv. Brought to Tel Aviv, and his trial was done, public trial, with camera trial was done to sort of hold him responsible for killing lots of Jews. And so that one can give him maybe 1,000 death penalties to this man, whatever they want to do. So Anaharan was asked by the New York Times to go and cover this trial. She's a Jew. She ran away from, she's a philosopher, and ran away from Germany under Zionist regime. And she was asked by New York Times to go and cover this trial. She wrote something about it which startled the world. She said, this man is innocent. She just wrote in New York Times that this man is innocent, not because he's not that man. He was a man behind concentration camp. He organized concentration camps. And all the rail routes, etc., entire structure of picking up people, and did it very well, very efficiently. And there can't be, if you look at his life, in those periods of 2.5 years, probably he was the most efficient of a person in Hitler's cabinet. And he was just doing his job. He was not really intending to kill anybody. He didn't agree with killing people personally, but he was following orders, and he did it very well. So this man is innocent. She wrote a book called Banality of Evil, that evil has become banal. It doesn't matter. Whether something goes wrong, you can always look aside. It doesn't matter, because you have your life. Which Israel did, hang this man. The judge hanged him. If you punish this man, you better punish the ministers of Israel. You better punish the corporate people and likes of Fords, etc. And you better punish them. Because there are recorded injustices which have happened because of their activity. And one can prove that. But nonetheless, their intention wasn't to hurt. They didn't really have intentions to hurt. But they may have ended up hurting. Like corporate world may not have intention to bugger up environment. But it has ended up like that. So there is something called a numb kind of individual, morally numb individual, which has become a kind of role or kind of persona which is being sought by the education system, which is, she also called it technocratic. And she said it is these people who constitute something called totalitarianism, which was Russia at that time, which was Nazi Germany, and which was Italy, fascist Italy. And the numbness, they don't care. They are just doing a job. These people will create totalitarian state. That was a very interesting analysis. She wrote a book, Banality of Evil, a critique of technocratic rationality, that a reason which can look away from human affairs, from human things. There is such a culture of reasoning which has come. And then we have John Rawls, who has come up with the theory of justice. Amartya Sen picks up from him in his thing, very popular. And then I quoted Anderson, more recent, who gave the phrase, imagination, that nation is the imagination. So I pick up from this this person onwards. I've tried to also show the role imagination has. Even society is entirely imagined. but not in your hand. I mean, you can't, you have to do deeds to change society. And deeds can have imagination behind, which will create, like people who have imagination of getting into CSR today, are the people who will do deeds, which will create those structures and things like that. So, another 15 minutes, let's look at polity from the first person, from the first principles. What really is politics? I'm going to give fundamentals of what politics is all about. I mean, we have a charged atmosphere these days because of democratic elections. So, since Rousseau, all the people, every individual, I'm talking to you people, you three, every individual is sovereign, including you people, including me. But doesn't mean I do something which hurts others. You know, it may hurt, it may minor hurt, like disturbance of class, but nonetheless, it hurts. So, that every individual, in a sense, is sovereign, is a king. Sovereignty sense is something, a sense of sovereignty is like sense of being a king and a queen. Everybody wants to have. The best way to have, easiest way to have that sense is, if you have lots of money, you go to a mall or somewhere, but you don't spend it. That you could spend, but you don't need it. So you don't spend it. That's a sense of sovereignty you get. I mean, you're sort of free, a sense of freedom. Every man is free, fundamentally, every man is sovereign. And there are certain sensations which come to a person and does some activity. That deed leads to this bubble. All kind of structures come up in this bubble. They are in our memory. They give rise to our cognition, and sensations are there. We reflect on that, make judgments. Judgment leads to action. Actions are deeds. Deeds create this structure again, change here. Only deeds can change what is inside. And then we have experience. Experience have sensations also along with them. And there is reflectivity. This reflectivity in us, which we begin this course by a term reflection, is a very fundamental thing in all of us. That leads to certain judgments, and judgment decide our actions. This cycle goes on. We look at this cartoon of man and construct polity. Polity out of this cartoon. Okay. Hopefully after this you'll understand what polity is all about. What is, so if we go to fundamental, what really is this man, each of us, whoever was a man and a woman. So what really is a person? In the Renaissance, there came an idea that a person is basically an animal. It's grown out like a sphinx. An individual is an animal. You scratch a person, inside there's animal. But there is a covering of reason around that animal. So this animal doesn't do sort of unexpected things. It doesn't kill around, it doesn't go around killing. It doesn't do bad things. And there is a rational kind of animal is what man is. Your deep inside you, your desires, your things like that, some things may happen inside your head. That is a private realm. Keep it to yourself. But publicly, you are a good person. This idea of a rational animal, the privacies can be sort of very many. Hide them. All privacies are hidden. We hide them. And because it's animal, not to be shown, not to be seen, and rest is rational. There was also idea, more laudable idea, of a noble savage. Inside man is savage, but aspiring to be noble, aspiring to be a great person, aspiring to be a, you know, a goodie, a good person, great person, I mean, aspiring to be a great thinker, aspiring to be a great industrialist, aspiring to be a great something, some noble thing. And there is a savage inside. When you're left to yourself, you are as good as savage. And the nobility remains in personas. The savagery dies in on death. This is a Renaissance picture of a man. A picture after Newton, after Descartes, etc. You have an image out of which a lot of modern polity is constructed. That I can't trust other unless until I verify that. This thing comes from the idea that there is a noble savage there inside you, or there is a rational animal inside you. There is another idea, very different from these two in Indian tradition, which says man as a dharmadharak. That man is fundamentally dispositional. Man is a has some tendency. Man is an organism having a tendency. What is disposition? When you change position, when you dislocate, something is carried through. In some invariance is carried through. Disposition in English means like disposition to talk, disposition tendencies. These are tendencies which work out. And these tendencies in English, it means that. But conceptually, it means whenever a position is altered, when you dislocate, in that something is conserved, that thing is called man. This is a very abstract way I'm putting it. The term dharma is very complex and very misunderstood term. Dharma is called as religion. So this phrase, dharmadharak, one who holds a religion. Dharma is a term, etymologically it means something worth holding. Dharma is that which is worth invariance, which is worthy of being invariant when you change positions. When everybody is with motor organs, one keeps changing position all the time. If you keep changing position, there is certain invariances which are kept, which are called dharma. For instance, dharma of a friend, dharma of a wife, dharma of a head of nation, or dharma of a chair, or a dharma of a chair also a dharma. Color is the dharma of chair. And fire has a dharma. It burns. Fire also has a disposition that it burns. So a man is defined as that who is a etymologically dharma means dharma comes from dharan, to hold. And in English, in Latin, cognate word to dharam is called firm. What is firm? To be firm on anything. Formus is a Latin term. To be firm about something when changes are happening, that thing is called dharma. And it so happens that there are many firms today. Some of them you will want to join, those firms. What are firms? Is to do something with dharma. Being firm is being steadfast, being resolute. And you have something like a firm called Microsoft. What is the relation between them? If you can think this up, you really have done some sort of humanities. And the Indian term, or there's an Indo-Greek, Indo-European family of language, which has roots are same. Firm and dharma has same root. If you look at etymology of firm, etymology of dharma, you will get firm there. And they have the same root. So one who holds firm, when sort of dispositions, positions are changing, is called man. That's a very strange definition. What we'll do is we'll develop on this definition and look at the structures of polity which are around us. So I was wondering, you know, what exactly is disinteresting about this course? What is disinteresting? I can't understand that portion, because sort of I'm teaching maybe because of that. But so that if one knows what is disinteresting about it, then maybe some improvement is possible. So I mean, you people should articulate that. What is disinteresting about this course? Just be bold. Say something. Huh? You said something? Just say something. Or you will be hero. Just say something. What is disinteresting about this course? It's good to understand that. Irrelevance in life, what is disinteresting? It's good to understand that. I mean, sometimes people have insights into world which are of great value, and others don't have those insights. No, okay, anybody who is sort of enjoyed this course, tell me what is disinteresting about this course. And people who like this course, etc., still can reflect on, there is a corner which is disinteresting, or something which is of maybe minimal value. It doesn't add any value. Some listing which adds no value to life. Or it doesn't add the kind of values you're wanting to add, but chunks of values in your life. It doesn't add those chunks. What is it? It's not a good question to think of. So maybe write to me anonymously. How do you write to him anonymously? How do you write anonymously? You could do that. Please take burden. Please, some people should take burden to write this. Or, you know, maybe just say type thing. Place it somewhere. Or where tears can't see, I can't see. Place it somewhere. If it has to be that, if there's a fear, Otherwise, say things, say something. What really is disinteresting about this course? In fact, I would be very interesting knowing them, knowing that, because I would know what to do with it. So I hope, I mean, I'm closing this class, hope that some people will write this, okay? Some people who have enough reflectivity in them would write that. Or next time I see somebody disturbing a class, I would think that person has written it. Because that person actually has more other things to do. And so one can take it like that. So do write. Okay.